For tonight's event, I'm happy to be welcoming Tom Nichols to the store to discuss his new book, The Death of Expertise, The Campaign Against Established Knowledge and Why It Matters. In this information age, it's easier, more easy than ever to get the answers you are seeking to questions about your health or consumer reviews or product information. But how do you know where that information is coming from? In his impassioned cautionary tale about the perils of unvetted information, Tom argues that credentials are still important and that giving experts their due is not undemocratic. Ian Bremmer, president and founder of Eurasia Group, said of the book, "We live in a post-fact age, one that's dangerous for a whole host of reasons. Here's a book that not only acknowledges this reality, but takes it head on. Persuasive and well-written, The Death of Expertise is exactly the book needed for our times." A professor of national security affairs at the U.S. Naval War College and an adjunct professor at the Harvard Extension School and a former aide to the U.S. Senate, Tom is the author of several other works on foreign policy and international security affairs, including The Sacred Cause, No Use, Nuclear Weapons, and U.S. National Security, Eve of Destruction, The Coming Age of Preventative War, and The Russian Presidency. And his real credential for this evening is that he is a 5-time undefeated Jeopardy champion and one of the all-time top players of the game. He was invited back to play in 2005 for the Ultimate Tournament of Champions. So please help me in welcoming Tom Nichols to Politics and Prose.
Hi, wow. Thank you. Thank you all for being here and for coming out tonight. And thanks. I know there's some folks here from the Twitter sphere, and there's also some old friends that I'm very happy to see and very touched that are here as well as my wife who is here. And I'll just start by saying, if there's any warmth or humanity in this book at all, it's because of her, not me. So a couple of things, some housekeeping. First of all, this is a company town, so you all know what I'm about to say next. Nothing I say reflects the views of the United States government or the Navy or Harvard or Connecticut Avenue or my hometown of Massachusetts or my cat or anybody but me. let me start first with why I wrote the book, what the book is in a nutshell about, and then move on to your questions as quickly as we can. First, why would I do this? Why would I write a book with such an unbelievably obnoxious title, such a pretentious subtitle, and this kind of in-your-face opening thesis that's guaranteed to just make people mad at you right off the bat? I did it because I didn't have much choice. But I can tell you that initially I did not start out on this whole subject to write a book. It started because I was just angry one evening. I sort of sat down at a blog I used to run, and as therapy, I sort of blasted off a couple of thousand words about why people keep arguing with experts. And that turned into, somebody noticed that. The editor at the Federalist noticed that, said, you know, can we have, they had just started up, and they said, could we have that piece? And I said, sure, who'd want to read this kind of, you know, old man yelling at clouds thing that I wrote? And within about a year or so, the piece had been read around the world by over 1 million people. And I realized that I may have struck a nerve out there in the world. And so at that point, Oxford actually suggested to me that I should turn this into a book-length project. And that's how the book was born. It didn't come out of the election. It didn't come out of anything recent that had happened. This is something that had been kind of brewing in my head for quite a while. Now, why is that? What is the problem that I think I identified here? It's not that people distrust pointy heads and intellectuals and eggheads. That's part of American culture. And actually, let me say that I actually think it's a very positive part of American culture. Tocqueville noticed it. Other scholars over the decades have written about American culture have noticed that Americans really are sort of skeptical, self-reliant people who rely on their common sense, which is, I think, part of what built our greatness as a country. That's not the kind of thing I'm talking about. we've gone from a healthy skepticism about experts to something different. We've gone to a kind of epidemic of narcissism where we all think we can replace experts. Well, we all think that what experts do can't be that hard, and we could probably do it better ourselves. And we've seen it not just in the United States, but we saw in the Brexit debate where the Brexiteers were saying, experts, who needs experts? We had a campaign where the winner and the current president of the United States said, who needs experts? What if I didn't have them? Would that be so bad? Well, I guess we're going to find out in real time, right now. What was different to me was not that people were doing the kind of thing they were doing to me, say, 30 years ago, when I first came here to Washington and I was working on, shows you how long ago it was, I was working on Soviet issues, which apparently I'll be working on again. But, you know, understandably, during the Cold War, people would say, listen, I want to talk to you about this because I don't want you lunatics to blow us all up. I'm scared. I think here's what I think we should do. I want to be involved in this. I understood that. What's different now is that when I tell people, well, I'm a specialist on Russia, the reaction I get is this. You're a Russia expert? Let me tell you about Russia. And I found that that no matter what the subject, I watched this happen to other experts. And as I started writing, and I did this first version of the blog and then the article and so on, people were coming to me with these kinds of stories. You're a lawyer? Let me explain the Constitution to you. Oh, you're a doctor? Here's some things you ought to know about germs. And it was just going on and on and on. And I started to wonder what had happened that had turned us all into this. And my touchstone early in the book, I mentioned the immortal character from Cheers, Cliff Clavin, the mailman. Right? If you're old enough to remember that series. Cheers was about a bar in Boston. My youngest daughter won't remember any of this, but Cheers was about a bar in Boston, and every bar had a know-it-all. There's always a guy at the end of the bar who was always sitting there and said, it's a known fact, right? And everything was premised with that. Studies have shown it's a known fact. Okay, every bar had that guy. What strikes me now is we're all that guy. We've all turned into this. We're all constantly lecturing each other on our... lecturing each other on each other's area of expertise. You're an electrician? I have some thoughts on that. You're an airline pilot? How hard can that be? And I started to worry about it because it's gone from a skepticism about knowledge and experts to an aggressive rejection of expertise. And if that happens, not only is our welfare endangered as people. I mean, that means that people don't get their vaccinations. It means that people, don't listen to their lawyers and they end up in jail. It means people end up broke, unhappy, whatever it is. It also means that the foundations of our democracy as a republic are in danger. Because we are not a democracy. We are a republic. And we rely on delegating decisions to other people who we assume are going to have some better knowledge of these issues than we are, or than we do. And those elected representatives have to rely on experts. I was an aide to a U.S. senator. And, in other towns, I have to explain what a U.S. senator does all day. I'm thinking this crowd's pretty clear on the job of a senator. But, you know, in the morning, it's childcare. In the afternoon, it's nuclear weapons. And by dinner, it's urban policy. And there have to be people to get those guys up. Now, congressmen, other decision makers, they can become experts in their field. My late boss was actually really probably his own best expert on elderly issues after years and years of working on those issues. But by and large, our republic functions on delegated decisions to others who rely on expertise to help make the best decisions we can make. If we reject that, then we just turn into a kind of an Athenian marketplace where we all have a plebiscite every day and we can change our mind at any given moment. I'll tell you that when it comes to Brexit, for example, as somebody who's primarily a conservative by nature, and I mean a small C conservative as well, in that I don't like sudden change. I don't like, large muscle movements in a republic without a lot of consideration. I thought it was really, although I didn't like the European Union when it was born, because by my nature, you know, I also didn't like big transnational bureaucracies that were going to tell people what to do. On the other hand, I didn't think that the way that you got out of that was to make a decision based on 51% of whoever showed up that day. And I think it's important to remember that our system of government is built specifically to prevent that. It was designed never to allow that to happen. And so when people say, well, we can't listen to the experts, we just have to do this ourselves and do this en masse with, you know, the people speaking as a whole. Well, that is fundamentally, to my mind, an un-American approach to the way we're governed, because our system of government was designed not to do things that way. Well, a couple of things about this. First of all, is it new? I think it is. I think that, and when I say new, I guess I will speak, you know, with the tired voice of middle age, and I say new in the sense of 25 years or so. But I think it's gotten worse. I think that this streak has always been there. I opened the book with a quote by Isaac Asimov, who talks about the cult of ignorance in American society. Well, Asimov said that in 1980. What's different, I think, is this replacement of experts. It's not just people arguing with their doctors. It's people saying, I've been on Google. I'm a doctor, too, or I'm as smart as a doctor. There are a lot of causes for this, and I identify three in the book that I wanted to talk about in particular. The role of higher education, which is supposed to at least cure some of this and is actually making it worse. The role of the media, which I think has I'll talk about that in a moment, but that the media has essentially become an entertainment complex rather than an information vehicle. And finally, the thing that everybody thinks is responsible for this, the internet. But I think it's very, very important to note, I don't blame the internet for the situation we live in now. I think the internet put all of this on steroids. I think it made it a lot worse. Because again, you know, we can all sit at that bar and say, well, as I happen to know right here, the galactic answer machine that's almost always wrong because you've asked it the wrong question. But this predates the accessibility of the internet. This notion of students lecturing back to their teachers, for example, one of my favorite things, really. You know, professor, there's a few things you should think about. Oh, well, please tell me. That predates the internet. So what's going on in higher education? One of the arguments I make is that higher education, in the competition for the endless supply of loan dollars that students will take out forever, is becoming very client-oriented. It's client servicing. Come to us. We'll give you a great college experience. It's almost like it's a multi-year vacation package. The dorms are great, the pizza's excellent, and no one will ever be mean to you. College is a place where people need to be mean to you. Dan Dresner, you put in a plug, and I think come and see Dan, because he's a very funny guy. His book is really important, and it's interesting. Dan makes a great point in his book where he says, college is where you go to say a lot of stupid things and have other people tell you how stupid they are. It's that time in your life where you're supposed to do that. But now this notion of telling students that, you know, the teachers are there for a reason, that the institution exists to get them from a place they're not to a place they ought to be, that is almost alien. They kind of look at you like, let me just add something here. I've had a very successful career as a teacher, so this is not axe grinding, okay? It's not like, oh, these kids, they always give me a bad recommendation. I've had a wonderful career teaching that's still going on. But there is definitely a change that began even a few decades ago, as I quote somebody who I can't name, of course, at a major university who said to me, I don't feel like a professor. I feel like a clerk in an expensive boutique. That's a real problem, because part of education is being able to tell the students they're wrong. I talk in the book about a beloved figure in my education. I did my doctorate here at Georgetown, and I had a Jesuit professor named Jim Shaw, and he used to begin class every year. He'd hand out an essay called What a Student Owes a Teacher. Imagine doing that today. And the essay says things like, students owe teachers, they owe to their teachers, docility, humility, trust. I mean, that would, you know, kids would be lighting that on fire on their desks. And I read it, and I thought, wow, you know, this was a little bit off-putting, but I struggled through the class, and I argued, you know, political philosophy with Father Shaw. And my reward for it was that I got to the end of the class, I got an A, and I, at Christmas, I walked up to this, again, this imposing Jesuit professor, and I said, thinking that I was now, you know, a made man because I'd gotten an A in this class. And I walked up and I said, what do you say, Father? Merry Christmas. Peace on earth, goodwill towards men. And he fixed me with a stare and he kind of looked over his glass and he said, what I say to you, Mr. Nichols, is repent. I think there should be more times of telling students to repent instead of telling them how awesome they are every day. And, that's unfortunately not happening because, again, there's this notion that everybody should go to college. So I argue there are too many students, too many colleges, too many professors. Yes, too many professors, too many PhDs out there, and that's part of the problem. The media has segmented into echo chambers. They no longer, journalism is no longer, and I realize I'm violating the prime directive, right? I am not a journalist, but I'm talking about journalism, but I talked with journalists, interviewed journalists, read studies, did the best research I could. And I think what's interesting is the news no longer tells you what you need to know. It asks you what you want to hear. And it's all segmented by your particular taste. And this is because there's so much bandwidth. There's so much time available 24/7 that it has to get filled. And when they run out of news, it turns into gladiator games. It turns into rollerball. And I think that's a serious problem because that's entertainment and people have a bottomless appetite for this and then somehow think they've been informed. Now, I grant you that an evening news broadcast in 1965 was pretty much the curated result of a bunch of old rich guys in New York deciding what you needed to know. You know what? Okay. Because if what they decided you needed to know meant that a nuclear arms treaty was more important than which Kardashian is sleeping with whom, well, then, you know, that's probably a trade-off I would take. I think there's something in between, though, that we have to demand better of. And I think journalists actually want to deliver. I think journalists actually want to be doing harder stories rather than, you know, 24 things your cat thinks is awesome. But unfortunately, we're getting the news we want. We're getting exactly what we ask for. And finally, the internet. Now, as many of you in here know, I am an active participant in social media. I love the internet. I like being on the internet. I enjoy it. I've met many wonderful people, many not so wonderful people. But I think it's a really important tool. And a really enjoyable place to be. It's like having every library in the world at your fingertips. Unfortunately, it's also having every flaming dumpster of nonsense at your fingertips as well. In the book, I talk about something called Sturgeon's Law. There was for those of you that are avid old school science fiction readers, Theodore Sturgeon was one of the great science fiction writers of the age in the 1950s and 1960s. And he took it very personally that literary critics thought science fiction wasn't very good, that it was kind of a ghetto of literature. And these literary critics said, well, science fiction is crap. And Sturgeon said, listen, 90% of everything is crap. And that became known as Sturgeon's Law. Well, if you think about applying this to the internet, there are a billion websites on the internet. If even if 10% of them are good, that's 100 million. That's great. It also means there's 900 awful dumpsters of nonsense out there. And most people, I'm sorry to say, simply don't have the tools or the intellectual preparation to weed through what's good or what's bad. I was on a panel a couple of nights ago in Charlottesville where a reporter from the Washington Post said most of our, I shouldn't say, I think he said most, but he said many of our stories are people who bounce and end up on our page from Facebook. And he said they don't even know they've ended up at the Washington Post. And, you know, we're really happy that, you know, Facebook leads that. But as I pointed out, the problem is the buried lead in there is that they don't know where they've ended up. It's great if they end up at the Washington Post. It's not so great if they end up at InfoWars or RT. And the problem is they don't know the difference. And that is really worrisome. So at the end of all this, I've been asked many times, what's the case for optimism? I don't have one. Good night. I think that this information bubble is going to burst at some point because we can't live this way. We can't live believing that so many things that are true turn out to be false. I want to say a word about fake news because it's a term that always comes up. Fake news, to me as a Russia guy, has a very specific meaning. It means news that was created out of whole cloth intentionally to be a lie and then planted out there, you younger kids know this expression, astroturfing. It's put out there like fake grass to look real when in fact it's not. Fake news, no matter what the President of the United States may say, is not stuff you don't like. And people use it that way now. Tom, you're putting on a few pounds. Fake news. You know, you shouldn't have a cheeseburger for breakfast. Fake news. Lying doctors. But that's unfortunately how we use it now, and we really have to stop doing that. As I say, we cannot go on this way. Now, I wrote the book, hopefully, to spark this kind of controversy and discussion. What I'm concerned about is the way that all this ends is the way most of these periods, these populist anti-knowledge periods end, which is in some kind of disaster that shocks people back to their senses. Nothing will put an end to the anti-vaccine nonsense, for example, faster than a pandemic. And if you really want to see that stuff go away, and, you know, parents fashionably talking about, you know, their belief exceptions and why they think, you know, magnesium causes abnormal tallness or all of the other theories that go along with this, a pandemic usually puts a stop to that kind of stuff pretty fast. And I don't want to see that happen. I don't want it to be at that point. I mean, what put an end to the isolationist populism of the 1930s? World War II. After World War II, people turned to the experts and said, hey, maybe we can construct a better international system out of this. And we did. There was a piece, some of you may have seen, it was a piece in USA Today, it was kind of critical of the argument. And the subtitle was, over the past 50 years, what have experts really done for us? Well, to which I answer, well, constructed an incredibly advanced, highly advanced civilization of peace and trade and global prosperity, that whatever the problems with it is still actually a pretty good system and certainly better than having to keep numbering our world wars. So I think in the end, my recommendation doesn't boil down to much more than, obviously, I put most of this on the shoulders of citizens, that you have to educate yourselves and you have to make better choices at the ballot box. You just do. And I don't mean that you have to make choices I agree with. You just have to be more informed about what you're actually doing in the ballot booth, in the voting booth. But also, experts have to start shouting back at the crowd more. And it doesn't come naturally to us. Most experts, I may be an extrovert, but most experts aren't. And they don't have the appetite for kind of wading into a crowd and saying, you're wrong, and you're wrong, and you're wrong. Come at me, bro. It's uncomfortable. I mean, I enjoy public speaking, but I find it uncomfortable. But it's going to have to be done. In the book, I declare war on the phrase, because I hate this phrase so much, let's agree to disagree. I hate that expression. So let's agree to disagree. No. Let's agree you're wrong. And I think that experts are just going to have to plant that flag in the ground a little more firmly and stand by that. But let me just anticipate what I know will be probably the first question, which is, how about the fact that experts get things wrong, that we're arrogant, that we lack empathy? It's been said that experts are arrogant and lack empathy. Well, I don't care. I do care. And I think it's a legitimate charge. Experts deal in the world of facts. They deal in the world of abstractions. They deal with models. They deal with data. And they do forget. There's no doubt about it. They do forget that they're dealing with human beings. And that, I think, is a tendency that it has always been there. My last book was on nuclear weapons, and I had to keep catching my breath at the way nuclear strategists throughout the 1950s and the 1960s, even in the 1980s. And I can tell you one of my own jobs where we were having a meeting about something and someone pointed a map and said, well, in that scenario, only 40 million people die. It was the first time I'd ever heard somebody put the words only in front of 40 million dead. So that is part of our problem. And I think we do make mistakes and we have to be more transparent about owning those mistakes. But part of that is speaking back to the crowd, because the public, increasingly as part of this war on expertise, the public seizes on our mistakes to say, aha, you didn't predict Donald Trump winning, so you don't know anything about politics. You didn't predict the fall of the Soviet Union, so you don't know anything about Russia. You got it wrong about eggs, and therefore you doctors don't know anything about medicine. This has gotten to ridiculous. This game of gotcha about expertise has reached ridiculous proportions because people are looking for any loophole that lets them out of having to listen to experts. And I think that's very dangerous. But I think that experts have played into that by withdrawing from the public sphere and saying, you know what? It's too difficult to talk to all of you, so we're just going to talk to each other in that weird jargon and specialized language that we experts used and just stop talking to the public. So I chide my colleagues about this regularly. I don't think there's anything wrong with being a public intellectual. I think experts need to get out there and take our lumps, but also to stand by the things we think are really important. Let me stop there, and there's a full house, so let me take your questions rather than keep talking at you. Thanks.
Thank you for coming, and thank you for retweeting me as I came up the hill tonight.
Oh, Randall. Nice to see you.
Nice to see you, too. Thank you. First off, thank you for mentioning fake news, mentioning that it's a term that will lead to disaster. It almost led to mass murder a few doors down from here.
First thing I thought of when I got out of the car, I went, oh, it's that close.
Yeah.
Okay.
And I guess my question is... I know I got the Trump election wrong. I know you did. I know a lot of people did. So I'm a bit hesitant to ask you this, but where do you think it ends for Trump? Where do you think it will? And I think, personally, I think it's going to end in some sort of disaster like you alluded to. But I just wanted to hear your opinion.
Yeah, I made a bad prediction, so invite me to make another one. Okay. Yeah. First, I think it's important to point out that when the experts who got the Trump election wrong, I love Nate Silver at the New York Times, who pointed out, he said, look, I said it was about a 65-35% chance. That means that every third time Donald Trump wins. I didn't say it was impossible. I said it was unlikely. And I liken this to the people who get mad at the weatherman, right? They say, well, there's a 70% chance of rain today. And then you go outside and they say, it didn't rain that day, which is that 30%. And they say, boy, those weathermen are stupid. They don't know anything. They were all wrong in the same direction, which suggests there was kind of a systemic error in the way people were looking at polling, and they're going to learn from this. That's how science progresses. It's not the first time that experts have called an election wrong. It won't be the last time. I don't know where this goes. I just don't know. We are in, see, those are the words experts hate to say. we're supposed to say things like, well, I have a theory on this, but I'm not ready to share it yet. I'm not going to say that. I'm just going to tell you I don't know. And I think, part of it is that we're in uncharted territory. I mean, I began life as an old Cold Warrior, kind of fighting the Kremlin. And then I went to saying, well, the Cold War's over. Maybe we should have a better relationship with Russia, to apparently just before I walked on stage here, apparently Mike Flynn just cut a deal with the...
Proffered
a deal.
He's asking for a deal, yeah.
I don't... The former national... The 3 weeks national security advisor just proffered a deal to testify about Russia. I can't make any sense of this at all. So I just don't know. And I'm buckled up. My one concern is that I don't want this to end. I think we can recover from any mistake at all, except war. And I don't mean the use of military force, because Americans, I think, have... we've looked at what's happened overseas, and we say, well, this is a terrible thing. I mean war, that, touches, the problem is our wars have been fought by volunteers and they've not touched us, I think, enough. That we've fought them on the cheap, and this is a bipartisan problem. You know, that we don't see it in our taxes, we don't see it in our home life. Very few of us meet or know veterans. I'm an exception, obviously, because I work with military people. But I mean a real conflict that could escalate to something very dangerous and potentially involve nuclear weapons. So that is the unrecoverable scenario.
Thank you.
Thanks for the question. Thanks for coming, Randall. Hi.
So I have a PhD in history, and until very recently I was teaching history at a university, and so your chapter on higher education was of particular interest to me. Most of that chapter, though, seemed to deal with, I guess I would say, campus culture, more so than the curriculum. But when I got to the end, you used this particularly nice turn of phrase, you know, borrowed from Ben Franklin, a republic if you know what one is. And that made me think about how in my teaching experience, it was very hard to say that there was any sort of baseline knowledge that I could expect from my students. And so what I would like to ask you is, do you think that curriculum does play a role in that decline of civic knowledge, civic participation, in terms of the, from kindergarten on, basically emphasis on STEM and that getting people jobs?
Yeah, that's a great question. I think the bigger problem is that because so much of education, I did not write a chapter on K through 12 because there are, right, the first thing you'd all say is, hey, expert guy, you never taught K through 12. So I stayed away from that. But I do think that from K through 12 into college, the education has adopted a therapeutic model of education, that it's about students and their feelings and about building the whole person and self-esteem and actualization and all of that stuff, and not about, you know, learning stuff. STEM is easy because I don't mean it's an easy subject. I mean it's something that escapes a lot of that because it's unarguable, right? So well, at least math, we can't argue over the politics of that. I think the bigger problem and the reason I focused on culture is, when you're constantly talking about affirmation and making kids feel good about themselves, you're killing their natural curiosity. Because you're telling them, you're smart enough already. You're a bright kid. You know stuff. When I was a kid, my parents bought us, like a lot of parents in the 1960s, they said, we don't know what the hell to do with you, so here's some encyclopedias. You know, they put them there. And I was like, I'm not reading that. And then the minute they weren't looking, I was like, okay, I'm going to read this because I don't know any of this stuff. Well, if you tell kids they know stuff, they're not going to crack that open, because why should they? They're doing fine, right? Again, I think the teachers who said to me, you know, aside from repent, the teachers who said to me, you have a lot to learn yet, Mr. Nichols, you know, I'd say, well, where is that? And I would go looking for it. But I think if you tell children, I'm okay, you're okay, we're all okay, then they say, all right, well, then I guess that's my day's done and I can go home and I can watch TV. So I worry about that culture. But I do think curriculum, yes, of course curriculum matters. It makes me crazy that, I have a teenage daughter and I've been watching her curriculum at schools, and she knows all about, for example, certain Supreme Court cases, but not what the Supreme Court is. Because it's in a test somewhere that you have to know Plessy v. Ferguson. She says, well, okay, I had to learn this, and somewhere someone's going to ask her a question about Plessy v. Ferguson. I said, well, but you understand what the Supreme Court is, right? No. So that's the problem. And I feel you, because I get those kids when they come into college, and I say, as we all know from the Constitution, and they all say, what is this strange Constitution you speak of? So I feel your pain, and curriculum is important, but I also think culture is even more important.
Hello, I'm another Twitter follower, and I appreciate your panic level that you post all the time to say, like, don't panic yet, I'll let you know.
Everybody, so every stay day, calm.
Every day I check it, I'm still calm.
Good.
I am married to a Marine Corps veteran, my husband here, and we are very interested in foreign policy. We obviously follow the news. So I'm not going to miss my opportunity with an expert in the room to ask you, What are you looking at in this schizophrenic existence that we're living in? Because there are days I wake up and Mattis or Kelly or McMaster or Tillerson says something and I say, oh, okay, oh, good. That is what we should be doing. Yes, this all makes sense to me, you know. And then 24 hours later, something completely different, whether it's handing Angela Merkel a bill or something else insane happens, and I panic again and think, well, wait a minute, Matt, maybe Mattis really isn't. I mean, what are you looking at? What are you monitoring to see which way we're actually going?
Oh, no, you don't. No, I don't actually tie my personal anxiety to any one thing. You're not going to do it. We're not playing that. Because the other person I watch when I'm judging my daily anxiety level is another governmental leader named Vladimir Putin. So regardless of what we're doing, I'm also kind of watching what he's doing. I think it's important not to read too much into any one news story at any given time, because all of them can look terrible at that moment, if you drill into it. One thing I'll say that I think we have to get over is the president, no matter who it is, President Obama, President Trump, the president is not a demigod. He is surrounded by hundreds and hundreds of other people in this town who are making things function every day. And I think one of the things that really makes me angry, aside from the, let's agree to disagree thing, is people say, well, you're in a bubble. The bubble I live in has 60 million people in it. You know, I think the people who think that Washington can't run without one ambassador being confirmed are the people who are in a bubble. Everybody needs to stay calm about that. Some of you may have seen, it was a local paper, Washington Post. I did a piece in the Washington Post where I said, chill out, everybody, mm-hmm. because they're just drilling down into this, looking for this. One thing, the government, as you here should know, maybe people out in the heartland won't see it, but you guys here know, the government runs because of the collective efforts of thousands, hundreds of thousands of people. With that said, sure, the president can make a mistake. I mean, if somebody tells me that, if I read a news story or if it comes over the wire and, the president had an angry phone call with Russia and slammed down the receiver and is now in an undisclosed location and everybody's evacuating Washington, I'm going to be concerned. Okay, you've got me. If a bunch of helicopters all get out of Washington at the same time, I'm gonna get a little curious about that. But you're not gonna see that happen, I don't think. But thank you for checking. I did an interview about 2 weeks ago with Wisconsin Public Radio, and I know they meant this as a compliment, but they asked me. They said, people do this, they check in with you, and they said, what's it like to be the internet's glass of warm milk? I said, well. Thank you, I think. Yes, ma'am.
Okay, this has been delightful. I think one reason that you say people coming from K-12 don't know very much about humanities is because I grew up in the 50s. I did the Newton school system, K-12. There's a lot less agreement now on what the curriculum should be and our relationship to the Constitution. And it's the history I grew up with is not the history I've learned since.
Right.
Speaking of history, you talk about there's a tradition of know-nothingism or common sense, or depending on which side you're on in American history. But don't you think there's a class element too now that, I'm a physician, those of us who are in the knowledge industry or experts are disregarded as the elite.
Yes.
And this is not bipartisan. I'm a liberal, and there was a difference between Hillary and Trump, and Hillary was dissed as elitist. I mean, she has a Yale degree. She knows a lot of stuff. She knows an awful lot of stuff. She never opens her mouth without doing the reading. That's a girl school thing from my generation.
Let me say a couple of things about this, because there's a lot to unpack here. First of all, surprisingly enough, when writing The Death of Expertise about this death of expertise problem, mm-hmm. I found that it is not actually a class problem. That remember that the lowest levels of vaccination are in places like Marin County, California, by people who are just smart enough to think that they're smart enough not to have to do this. The people, I talk in the book about the raw milk movement. You know, people say, oh, it's great to drink raw milk. You know, meanwhile, yeah. Louis Pasteur and billions of scientists roll in their graves. But this is not poor people saying, hey, I really need to drink out of a cow. This is people who are fashionable. Now, we all laughed about this until a couple of weeks ago. Two people in upstate New York died from eating raw milk products. Just the way science might have actually, you know, predicted that you will eventually die from drinking or eating unpasteurized products. So that is definitely part of it. But the thing you've zeroed in on that's really important is the conflation of the word expert with the word elite.
Yes.
And I keep trying to explain to people, and there are plenty of people in this room who actually knew me when I was a kid. I did not grow up in an elite environment. My parents, my mom dropped out of high school in ninth grade. My dad dropped out in 10th. I grew up in a factory town that is now full of dead factories. I mean, I grew up in Western Massachusetts, which is a lot like Western Pennsylvania or Southern Ohio or a lot of other places right now. And so when people say to me, well, you're an elitist, I think my parents somewhere in heaven must be like laughing. The idea, you know, our son, have you met the guy? But I think the reason this is happening is because as we've moved into an information age, the winners and losers in the modern era are not people who make a lot of money and people who don't make a lot of money. It's the it's the divide, not in money, but in respect between people who know stuff and people who don't know stuff. And the people who don't know stuff, no matter how much money they make, I think, you know, again, the president's a great example of this, feel like they're not respected because they're not able to keep up with everything that's going on. You know, it always struck me where I live in Rhode Island that I was talking to guys who had a high school diploma and had been working guys their whole lives and lived in $500,000 homes who said to me, you know, this has all got to change. I said, what? Seems to be working pretty well for you. But it was this sense of, I'm not respected because I don't know all this stuff that's going on anymore. I don't have this same level of cultural literacy. And I don't want to get into the election. I'll leave one comment here about Hillary Clinton. And those of you who want to know what I thought about Clinton, I wrote a lot of articles about this that are out there. The problem was Bill Clinton had that same Yale degree, right?
That's right.
And yet he somehow got away with it. Nobody ever said Bill Clinton was an elitist because he stood there and he kind of did the thing and he sort of, you know. I think the problem was that Hillary Clinton played into the stereotype of an educated elitist. Yeah. I mean, she just kind of radiated disdain. And now, again, this is my personal feeling about it, kind of radiated a lot of disdain about people that just were not from that background in a way that Bill Clinton didn't. I mean, I was not a Clinton fan in the 90s, but as a political scientist, I have to say, probably one of the most gifted natural politicians of the modern era. And she just wasn't. And so I think she played right into that notion that, you know, people with a lot of education just don't like ordinary people. What bothers me is the notion that if you gain a lot of education, you are not ordinary people anymore. And I'll finish our comment, move on to your next question with, there is a story I tell right at the beginning of the book. My half-brother, much older than I am, retired cop, the stereotype of a retired cop, big guy, you know, and then did what all retired cops should do. He ran a bar, right? and since there are people in this room who've been there, it's a compliment even to call it a bar. It was more like a joint. And when I was a young professor, I would go down and I'd see my brother. It was in New England, and I'd drive down and I'd come and I'd kind of hang out at my brother's bar and I'd sort of, you know, shoot the breeze. And one night I walked out. My brother told me this story afterwards. I walked out and a guy turned to my brother and said, "Is your brother, he's a professor?" And my brother said, "Yeah." And the guy went, "Seems like a good guy anyway." That was years ago. And it was that notion that if you're a professor, by definition, you're probably not a good guy. So that now has reached epidemic proportions, where it used to be, you know, a bar in a mill town. It's now everywhere. So
thank you.
Thank you. Thanks for the question. Hi.
Hi.
I'll try and keep the answer shorter so we can get to.
I'm Samira Daniels. I am actually very interested in the whole topic of expertise. I follow Philip Tetlock's IARPA project tournaments on the quality of expertise.
I talk about Tetlock in the book.
Oh, fantastic.
I do.
But I just want to push back a little bit on how you've characterized the contrast between, you know, the non-expert and the expert, the non-experts like in the streets, ordinary people.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that the issue really has been that the expert is also a careerist. And in that pursuit of ambition, I think, you know, with the corporatization of universe, you know,
everything,
the special funding of research and so forth. A great the contrast between the observational studies
mm-hmm.
and controlled randomized studies has distinguished the good expert from the excellent.
Okay.
And I think we're seeing more of that battle, and I think it's a ubiquitous longitudinal battle of the good versus the great, as Jim Collins. And I think
let me say a couple of things about that. Did everybody hear the question? This question is about the professional, about the careerism of professionals or of experts. You say careerist, I say professional.
Okay.
That is to say, we can't just walk away from it, right? I'm one thing I think where experts don't get their due is. If you know a doctor makes a bad call, or a teacher is a lousy teacher, or a lawyer tends to be a lousy lawyer, he doesn't say, "Well, hey, it was just my weekend hobby." You can't really hold me responsible. We're held responsible by ourselves. One mark of a profession is that it polices itself. Now, sometimes incompletely, sometimes that doesn't work. There are bad doctors out there who slip through. There are bad teachers. Believe me, I know. But the idea that somehow because we're making a living at it, and this is something I really push back on, people say, well, you defend experts because you make a living at it. Well, we all make a living at something.
No, that's not my argument. I was saying that the good versus
the other problem is that you're right, that there is that the real distinction between experts is the ones that are merely competent and the ones that are really amazing.
Yes.
My only argument in the book, and this is where I've tried to bring this back to it, is look, there are some professionals who are very good, and there are some who are marginally competent. But in their field, they're going to be better at it than you. No, I'm sorry.
I'm sure.
You know what?
It's fine.
Pull your own tooth and get that, right? This is the problem. And that's not to say that there is no room for the talented amateur, because that can happen,
yeah,
right? You get the guy. I love that. What was it called? Flash Inspiration. I can't remember the name of the movie. The guy who invented the intermittent windshield wiper. I love that guy. Flash of genius, right? Where he says, hey, windshield wiper, and all these engineers stood there going, well, nobody, that's ridiculous. This guy in his basement said, I can make a windshield wiper that does this. The problem is, that's pretty rare. And when everybody in society says, I'm that guy, then things start to fall apart. Because what I encounter increasingly is that everybody in society says, when I tell kids, for example, you don't have to go to college. But if you go to college, you should at least try and finish. Because there's value in finishing things. There's value in, getting through the... They say, well, Bill Gates didn't. Okay, well, guess what? You're not Bill Gates. And you're not Mark Zuckerberg. And this notion that, well, why can't I be? Because, and I'll leave you with this quote, which is one of my favorites, and I kept over my desk for years. Ernest Hemingway said, there are two real requisites necessary to becoming a writer. One is a real seriousness about writing. And then he said, the other, unfortunately, is talent. And I say in the chapter on experts, in the end, that last thing, and I think the thing you're talking about that defines those really great experts, is talent.
Yeah.
There are a lot of people that can be trained to be marginally competent, but the really good ones will have some talent that over time and experience will show through.
Something like that, yeah. Thank you.
So I recognize a lot of the worst aspects of the qualities that you're talking about in myself.
I know.
In moments of introspection. But if I think about 40 years working in healthcare, not-for-profit side, for-profit, being on boards, dealing with physicians. If I think of 65 years of living and friends, I could not name five women who exhibit the kinds of qualities that you're talking about. I would be here for years talking about all the men that I know. It feels to me like a lot of the issue, particularly of the rejection of having to have any degree of knowledge to be able to speak with confidence about subjects, and to reject other people's opinions, feels very, very male.
Oh, First of all, I totally feel your pain about recognizing yourself in the pages. There were more than a few times when I was writing where I had to kind of step back from the computer and say, oh, this guy I'm talking about is such a jerk. But I also don't think, I think it's true that men and women communicate differently. Men do, I think, more than women talk to establish dominance, for example, and they are more likely to say, let me tell you. Right? You don't usually get a woman who wades into a conversation and says, all right, I'm going to explain a few things to you. In fact, I did this talk at the Harvard Coop a few weeks back, and a woman in the audience said, can you kind of tell me where this integrates with mansplaining? And there was this very heavy pause in the room, and I said, listen, honey. But with that said, I think that in some ways, let me speak for men for a moment. I actually think that men who operate much more on things like hierarchy rather than consensus. That's what I was looking for. Sorry, hierarchy versus consensus. I have found that, for example. At least in my experience dealing in the social media world with the anti-vaxxer movement, for example, it's almost all women.
That's interesting.
It's moms. You know, and that, this notion of, well, doctor, you know, that the studies and that because I think, you know, men tend to be, and as an intuitive rather than analytical thinker, I sympathize with this, but I think men tend to be overly analytical. I think women tend to be intuitive. I think men tend to generalize, women don't. You know, we're generalizing, obviously, about, thank you for getting that joke. Whew, man, that was a close one. But I do think there are differences in the way men and women approach information and data, but I don't think that has to do with the situation I'm talking about. I think it has, it manifests itself in different ways in men and women, that they will express it differently. But again, some of the most ardent, you know, GMOs, or, you know, wade into the abortion debate, where, you know, whose side is science on? I mean, that there are plenty of males and females who will make these kind of same category errors, confirmation bias, unwillingness to accept new information. So I don't think, I agree with you that the kind of most obnoxious version of it is men. There's no doubt about it. But I don't think it's limited to men at all.
Thank you.
It was a great question. Thanks. You.
We can take just two more questions.
Two more. Hi, Steve.
Hey, Tom. How are you?
Good.
I'm from the conservative, Stephen Bates, from the conservative bastions of Vienna, Virginia, and Rehoboth Beach. So I'm kind of in a bubble out there. And our mutual friend, John Schindler, 20 Committee, sends his regrets. He's not here today with us. So I want to go back.
Bordeaux sent me a note, too.
Did he? I want to come back to the idea of fake news and the dearth of, how shall I say, popular conservative thought leaders. We haven't seen them since Buckley and Sapphire and so forth. We see a few on the internet, Rick Wilson and a few of the others. But I want to get my pink pussy hat wearing friends off of HuffPo and Elephant Journal and to start reading some serious thought leadership from conservative writers. And I want my conservative friends to stop watching Fox News and Breitbart and everything else and start to read some long form journalism in print the way you've highlighted here in this book. So what techniques can I do to bring these two together and read conservative thought leaders and disparage these other sort of fringe benefits and bring them back to the mainstream?
Well, it depends on how many friends you want to have when you're done.
I do.
Somebody yesterday asked me, so how do you talk to friends and family about this? I don't know. How well do you like your family? For 30 years, I've been walking into classrooms since the day I started teaching and telling students to stop reading everything they agree with. And to find at least one thing once a week or once a month that annoys them. And I think that's how you have to put it. Look, you have to find if it didn't make you mad, then it's probably, and you know, I'm not equating anger with thought, but if everything you read, if everything you watch, everything you read, you walk away from it saying, yeah, it seems fine to me, you're not challenging yourself. I mean, really good political literature of any kind, whether it's punditry or novels, should have some kind of an emotional impact on you. Part of the reason I'm not a chemist today, which was my first major, out myself as a nerd, you know, aside from the fact that I wasn't in love with mathematics, I was in love with chemistry, but I also made the mistake of, at 16 years old, I picked up 1984. And I just wasn't this. I was like shaken up for days. And I just wasn't the same. And I started reading everything across the spectrum from left to right to kind of figure out who I agreed or disagreed with. And I think it's not that hard to do. And people, I think one of the things you can do, you as citizens can do, is not accept lame excuses from your friends about it. I said to people, they said, well, how do you stay informed? And I said, well, my personal favorite, partly because I worked in politics here and it's an old habit, I like the Washington Post. I don't agree with everything in it. I liked it before I was ever published in it, just to be clear about that. You know, it's like, hey, their opinion page is really smart. I said, I start with that. And they said, well, I won't read the Washington Post. It's too biased. I said, all right, read the New York Times. So, no, that's a bunch of commies. All right, read the Wall Street Journal. Rich people. What they're saying is, I'm not going to read anything because I already made up my mind. And I don't want to read Huffington Post. I don't want to read Mother Jones. I don't read National Review. When I worked in the Senate, for those of you that are going to ask, it's the late John Hines of Pennsylvania. And he's a Republican. He's one of those northeastern moderate Republicans who's been kind of hunted to extinction at this point. But I made it a point. I had a subscription to the American Spectator and National Review. I also had a subscription to Mother Jones and The Nation. And I read them all because I wanted to know. I mean, when I was talking to my other staffers or listening to debates on the floor, I wanted to know, what are these guys reading? And I think that's another way you can put it. First of all, stop being lazy. When people say, well, I don't have time to do that much reading, you have time to sit around and watch crap all day long. You have time to watch reality TV. You have time to do this. And the other is to challenge them and to say, look, even if you hate all this stuff, wouldn't you like to know what your worst enemy is thinking, right? Call it intel. Call it, you know, intelligence research. And I say, look, you know, if you're a student, for example, and you're trying to, I've had young conservative students come to me and say, how do I be an effective conservative? I say, start reading The Nation. Start reading Mother Jones. You already know what you believe. Forget that stuff. That you'll figure that out over the years. Read the stuff that really annoys you. And I would challenge them to do that and not take no for an answer. Not take the New York Times is liberal and I don't have time and it's too expensive. I love that one in the age of the internet. Well, it's too expensive, you know, free. So take them on and don't let them wriggle out of it. And say, and I have actually said to people, until, I guess those of you who know me on Twitter know that I've done this. I've said to people who've engaged me on social media, oh, you didn't read the article? I'm not talking to you.
Yeah.
We're done.
Okay.
I didn't read, if you guys, some of you guys follow me on Twitter, I haven't read your book, but I have a very strong feeling about it.
That was the Amazon quote. I remember that.
Yeah. That's what the mute button was made for. So.
Thank you. Jezebel reports tonight. You've got about 1 million, maybe 1.5 million here tonight.
Is that what it is? Okay, thank you. Largest ever. Huge. This is a bigger crowd than Obama ever got at Politics and Prose.
Trying to scare you. A bigly crowd.
Thank you so much, Professor Nichols. I have a comment. No, I'm just joking. really, really quickly, as someone who's lived in China, Nigeria, and Ghana, and I'm actually pretty aware of the way...
Let me tell you about China.
Thank you.
Has this happened to you? I'm saying,
more than you would expect. Oh, no, actually, no, more, the book
totally
on it.
As much as I would expect, right.
But in terms of how politics works in other countries versus the U.S., and I feel you are probably going to push back on this, Your book is really fantastic, really interesting, especially in how it intersects with the culture of a rejection of expertise. But as a political project, I find that this is something that is part and parcel of conservative politics post-Goldwater. And not that liberals don't do this. The anti-vax movement, as someone whose father died from malaria, like, angers me to no end. But I don't know how you can fix this, because for conservative politicians, attacking expertise works. And you're a fantastic public intellectual. You're an honest public intellectual. We're not going to agree on everything, but the stuff that you've done, I really agree with. But on this is something that,
where we just have to agree to disagree. No, you want, look. I'm not gonna argue with you. But I think. It's not. I'm sorry. We don't.
I'm done-ish.
Look. It's not. I think it's become over. It's become fashionable to say, well, the Democrats are the party of science and the Republicans are the party of ignorance. I mean, remember, you know, part of the reason I was attracted to conservatism as a young man was people like Buckley, where to me I think the better rap on conservatives versus liberals is the conservatives were all brain and no heart back in the day, right? The conservatives were the ones who said, well, you know, this is the way it is, and Buckley would sort of, you know, lean back and say, oh, you know, and liberals were the ones who are banging the podium. I think what you're actually going to find is that what you're centered on and what you and I would be centered on are the arguments among intellectuals in the two parties where science becomes a bargaining chip between them, right? About climate change or when, you know, you want to see liberals start to get jumpy about science. When does human life begin? Oh, that's, suddenly that's science isn't cool anymore. Suddenly science is all the realm of squishy religion. And that each side will deploy science in the way that it is advantageous to its argument. Does early childhood education work? Oh, yes. Well, it's not the way we thought. And, you know, liberals and conservatives will do this. Where I think the Republican and conservative populist movement, because I don't think those are the same at all, where that has overtaken the Democrats, I would say, is in this thing we talked about earlier, fusing the idea that experts and elites are the same people. And so that you can encourage people to strike back against these elites and fire up this populist feeling by encouraging people to identify elites as anybody with education. And that was let's face it, I didn't think it would work in 2016. I didn't think there were that many people without education who could, you know, make the difference in a national election. Clearly, the Trump campaign strategists were right and I was wrong. But I think that is a transitory problem here, where this notion of putting elite and expert together. Now, part of my project is to pull those back apart, because there's a lot of people. I mean, look, plumbers and electricians are experts. And they've come to me, and people who are in trades have come to me and said, man, you know, if I'm sitting there with a drain, you know, blowing up in my face, one more time the homeowner comes in and says, what are you using there for a wrench? Like, what? Oh, I'm sorry, we're going to discuss this now? You know, a wedding photographer said to me, every place she sets up, somebody walks over and says, that's great. What lens are you using? Everybody is suffering from this. I think that, yes, this election, the Republicans mobilized that anger against this generalized elite and melded it to experts more effectively. But I think this attack on, let's go beyond expertise, call it the attack on the division of labor. Because that's kind of what it is, right? You may have all seen that great New Yorker cartoon that everybody in the world sent me. Thank you, all 70,000 of you, where a guy says, I think the elitist pilots up front have lost touch with the passengers. Who thinks I should fly the plane? Right? That's the new thing. I don't think that's limited to, I mean, I was just on the way here. I was showing my wife a cool map that Patrick Ruffini had done of showing the flips. These are not party affiliation. Now, this lady over here had asked me about class. Some of this is class, where all of, you know, Northern Michigan flips from Obama blue to Trump red. That's not people deciding, well, Republicans hate science and Democrats love it. That's people just, you know, deciding who the elites are that they hate the most and who they can tag that on. And that goes back to my comment to you, ma'am, about, well, you know, Hillary kind of played into that and made it easy. But if I thought this were just a partisan problem, I wouldn't have written the book, because I think most partisan problems are transitory. And I started writing the book years ago, at least 2-3 years ago. So I think that there's a bigger social illness that's out there. But in this election cycle, I cannot help but take your point and admit that it was certainly mobilized and deployed better this time around by the Republicans than the Democrats. No question about it. Is that it? Okay. Well, I'll be here, so thanks for coming.